Bullseye with Jesse Thorn is a production of MaximumFun.org and is distributed by NPR.
I'm Jesse Thorn. It's Bullseye. It wasn't long ago, less than 10 years, that record labels used to send us dozens and dozens of unsolicited CDs in the mail. So many unsolicited CDs. And obviously, we all know why record labels aren't spending any more money on thousands and thousands of free CDs for radio producers and DJs and music critics and so on and so forth. But it was a nice time in my life. That was actually how I heard about my next guest. I was doing this show out of my apartment in Los Angeles, and we got a CD. It's a black and white photograph on the cover, a picture of a man's hand. And on the hand, there is a woman's face. The band was called Black Moth Super Rainbow, and the title was Eating Us. And I listened to it mostly because I thought the cover was interesting. I had no idea what to expect. It turned out it was great. Rich and kind of dirty and unsettling. There are all these old synthesizers and bits of tape distortion and weird processed vocals. They sound a bit like Boards of Canada or maybe David Bowie or Nine Inch Nails. It's very difficult to describe, but I couldn't stop listening. So I was excited to book an interview. I mean, who was Black Moth Super Rainbow? So I asked the publicist, and the publicist emailed me back very politely, sorry, they don't want to do any publicity at all. In fact, when they perform, they wear masks. So I just tabled it. As it turns out, Black Moth Super Rainbow is basically this one guy. His name is Tom. He lives in a house in Pittsburgh. He records also as Tobacco and has put out a bunch of albums under that name, too. If you've seen the show Silicon Valley on HBO, there's a Tobacco song in the opening credits. Anyway, we asked again just recently, and Tobacco said yes. We're so grateful he did. Before we get into the interview, let's hear one more Black Moth Super Rainbow song. This one's off their latest record, which is called Panic Blooms. The song is We Might Come Back. Tom Tobacco, welcome to Bullseye. It's nice to have you on the show.
Thanks.
What was your first instrument?
Guitar. I think I was like 15. My cousin taught me how to play.
Where'd you get it?
I think I got it for Christmas. I'd kind of been into music for a couple of years. I don't know, my parents thought it'd be a good idea. Maybe do something constructive.
I read a story somewhere that you were talking about hitting your teenage years, and your dad got you a subscription to CMJ, the College Music Journal, I think it was, and just listening to the CD that came with it every month. And that's like an unusual version of the I had an older sister story as to where you learned that music was more than just what was on the radio.
Yeah, I miss that. I miss that magazine. Yeah, I found everything through that. This was like probably like 1 year before my parents had the internet. Yeah, it was cool. It was cool. I wish it was still around.
Did you have buddies that were into it? I mean, were there like punk rock kids or, you know, underground hip-hop heads at your school, or was it a solo pursuit?
We were more into like, you know, we were more like the Aphex Twin kind of kids. Aphex Twin, Otiker, Boards of Canada. That's probably why I got my first synth. I thought everything had to be done with a guitar for a long time, and then that kind of changed everything.
Were you recording yourself when you were playing as a teenager? I mean, your music is so deeply connected to sounds on a recording, you know what I mean? Relative to writing a song to play at a party or something.
Yeah, it's all about the recording. That's like my world. That's why I take that part of it like so seriously, because that's what, you know, that's what it all is to me. Yeah, I never saw myself playing live. Never thought I would be on stage. Never wanted to be on stage. It's still like not in love with being on stage.
What was the first synthesizer that you got?
It was a Yamaha CS5. It's probably the only one I could afford at the time. Super cheap. I don't know how much they are now, but I remember it being like really cheap back then, like 2003, maybe 2002, like $50 maybe.
What could it do?
It was a monosynth, and I didn't know what that meant. So it can only play one note at a time. I didn't know what any of the knobs did. I just turned them until it sounded the way I wanted it to, you know? It couldn't do much, but there's a Black Moth album called Start of People, and pretty much the whole thing was made on that. Most of it, at least.
Did you have buddies that you were making music with?
You know, throughout everything I've been doing, there's always been people around. But like at the end of the day, I always made it. 99.9% of it, I made it alone. I just never knew how to be in a band. I still don't. I wish I could sometimes, but I don't know. It's like I have something to prove. Something. I'm not sure.
What happens when you try to be in a band? I mean, you are in a band in the sense that when you tour either as Tobacco or as Black Moth Super Rainbow, both of those are not just you on stage, but what happens when you try to work with other people?
Like once every like 4 years or something, you know, in rehearsal, we'll decide like, oh, maybe we should try to like write something on the spot. And it becomes like the worst burden. And it's probably me bringing it down because I can't feel it, you know? I think I just need to be in my space or something. I don't know.
I had a friend in college who was always noodling around on his guitar watching like a UHF rerun of News Radio or whatever. Then one day, I think his junior year of college, he like came, he's like, hey guys, I made an album. And we were like, we didn't even know you were writing songs. I just thought you were like playing Led Zeppelin riffs to entertain yourself. And I wonder, when did you start making the music that you were making public?
Pretty early. Too early. Like as soon as my parents got the internet, I found like there was this website called mp3.com.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone like me who like wasn't ready to be uploading their stuff would upload their stuff. I just thought, I always believed in it, even if it, when you know, you look back on it now and it's like some of it's terrible, but it was like as soon as it was done, I wanted to get it out there. And I don't think that's a good thing. I think that's if I could change one thing, I would probably go back and like stop myself and like try to like curate and wait until things got a little better. Because I think you kind of shoot yourself in the foot when you put yourself out. You know, when you're putting your first ideas that haven't really had any time to marinate, you kind of run the risk of turning people off to what you do. Because it's that first impression thing, you know?
So why do you think you put out your music too early? Were people being mean to you about it?
No, I just wasn't. I wasn't fully formed. It was a little premature. My lungs weren't developed all the way. I don't know. Just looking back on some of this stuff now, it's like, had I just waited like a year, maybe. But that's my own, like everything I ever do, I'm always going to look back on it critically and wish I had done it a different way.
Do you have a hard time embarrassing yourself?
I don't know. I mean, I probably embarrass myself every single time I'm on stage. And I get paid for it.
What was it like the first time that you went on tour?
The first time we went on tour, it was pretty surreal. We weren't all getting along that great. And we had been asked by the Flaming Lips to go out for a month. That was 2007. So that being my first tour was hard to process. I can think about it now and like man, I like did not deserve to be there. Anyway.
Had you done much live performing at all at that point?
We would do like two shows a year, like locally, or like sometimes we would go to Chicago. We had done like 3 or 4 years of a few shows every year. So like probably, I don't know, like 10 shows or something by that point.
How big a room were the Flaming Lips playing in 2007? I mean, did you just step in front of a 1,500 seat theater or whatever?
It was more than that. It was like, I mean, first off, like at that point in my life, like anything over like 200 people seemed like huge to me. So I think our first show with them, it was in this place called the Aragon Ballroom in Chicago. And I don't know how many people that is, but it's got to be more than 5,000. It was crazy. I did not deserve to be there.
Why do you think you didn't deserve to be there?
I don't know. imposter syndrome? I don't know.
I mean, was it because you weren't prepared to put on a show that merited 3,000 people watching it? Or was it because you feel like you had some kind of moral failing?
I feel like maybe like, even though like we had been together for a while, for like a few years, and like a lot of practicing in the basement, and like we knew what we were doing, but I don't know, it just felt like we like hadn't like worked for it or something, even though we had. Like I said, it's imposter syndrome. Like everything. I'll tell you, I don't deserve anything.
Were you already anonymizing yourselves at that point in the band's history?
Yeah, I mean, it's not like there was any need. Like, it's not like anyone cared. We were anonymous. We didn't have to tell people we were being anonymous. I forget exactly when I picked out the name Tobacco, but I had a DVD on that tour for sale. It was the first Tobacco album, like a year before it came out, but it was put to video. So I was that person or thing by that time.
How did you decide how you were going to present yourself, besides just that it wasn't going to be, you know, your government name?
Like how we were on stage?
Yeah, I mean, I feel like Kiss probably did some marketing surveys. Figured out, so it was, oh yeah, okay, I'm the demon, he's the cat, you know? But what did you do? Did you go to the drugstore at Halloween and pick out a mask and go from there? Or did you pick out a name and think about what it meant to you and
Like, what were the steps?
It was all kind of natural. Everybody's name meant something to them at the time, and everyone had like their own solo thing. So that's mainly what everyone went by, like whatever their solo project was called. But the mask thing, that was like, we didn't wear masks as much as it was written about that we wore masks. I can really only remember wearing a mask like maybe like two or three times. If you write about yourself in a certain way, I didn't learn this until way after the fact. Like people just like, they start to just believe that, I guess. And someone had written about us wearing masks. And so that's just kind of followed us through, you know, over the past 10 years. But we mainly just hide, you know, it's like none of us like love being on stage. I know that I would rather, it's really nice to play for people who want to hear what you're doing, that they would even give you that opportunity. But I'm not that guy, you know, I'm just not comfortable.
We have even more with tobacco. Stay with us. It's Bullseye for MaximumFun.org and NPR. This message comes from NPR sponsor, Smartwater. Smartwater is for the curious drinkers, the ones who are always looking for ways to make things a little bit better. That's why Smartwater created two new ways to hydrate, Smartwater Alkaline with 9+ pH and Smartwater Antioxidant with added selenium. And now you can order Smartwater by saying, Alexa, order Smartwater. Smartwater, that's pretty smart.
Did you know about the Cuban connection to Cuban jazz or how mambo influenced early rock and roll? I'm Felix Contreras, host of NPR Music's Alt Latino podcast. I'll tell you about all those exciting stories and much more in some special programming I've cooked up for Latino Heritage Month. Listen and subscribe to Alt Latino from NPR.
I'm Travis McElroy.
I'm Courtney Enlow.
I'm Brent Black, and we're the hosts of Trends Like These.
Trends Like These is an internet news show where we take the stories trending on social media and go beyond the headlines.
We'll give you the actual facts of the story and not just the knee-jerk reactions.
Plus, we end every episode with a ray of hope that we call the Wi-Fi of the week.
So join us every Friday on Maximum Fun.
Or wherever you get your podcasts.
Trends Like These, real-life friends talking internet trends.
It's Bullseye. I'm Jesse Thorne. My guest is Tom Fec. He's a musician and songwriter. He records solo as Tobacco. He records also as the band Black Moth Super Rainbow. When people come up to you after a show and tell you what your music means to them, are you able to accept what they say?
Yeah, it's sort of. Sometimes all I can do is stand there and just keep saying thank you because I don't know how to like live up to maybe what they think I am or, you know, the things that my music means to them. I'm not always sure that I can live up to that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I can accept it, but especially like the past few years, I've really grown to appreciate that, like when people tell me story, like, you know, like the last Black Moth album had a lot to do with depression, stuff like that. And a lot of people coming up to me talking about that. And it's like, it was really nice.
I have a really hard time hearing it. I mean, I hear it, like it doesn't make me mad or anything. I just have a really hard time being present when people are speaking to me in that way. And then I feel guilty about the fact that I am having a hard time being present with them when this is an important thing.
I think it was like that for me because I just didn't know how to take it. Some kind of switch flipped. You can just, I don't know. It's like now I can just focus in like completely on them, you know, try to like really listen. It's like meditation or something.
How do you think you got there? What changed?
Maybe making a record that wasn't so ambiguous. I think making a piece of work that had like a really strong meaning. To me, that's like kind of corny, but it kind of opened my eyes to some things. And it just changed the way I was able to interact with some people because of the way they come at it. It's not anymore. It's not just like some like a hippie person coming up to you, like talking about how much they love to listen to my music on acid. It's like someone who went through some stuff and they relate to some things I'm saying. As you know, as weird, kind of out there as some of the things I say on that album, it all makes sense, I think, maybe, when you've been through that stuff.
It must have been hard for you as somebody who was pretty invested in putting up a separation between your art and the voice of your art and your personal self to make a more thematically direct record. I mean, like, you know, on Black Moth Super Rainbow albums, not only are you performing as a pseudonym on the record, and not only are, you know, many of the beautiful things arced and warped and twisted in some way, and not only, you know, you're also singing through heavy processing, so your voice is more an instrument than it is a direct reflection of yourself. You know what I mean? Like, you had gone through a lot of steps to be one step to the, to have yourself be one step to the side of your art. And it must have been tough to make something that was more about you.
Yeah, I mean, but also, like, as serious as that one was, and even though some of the other ones weren't so serious, it kind of also helped me realize that, like, that stuff, it's always been about me. I just didn't even know it at the time. It didn't click, because, like, I had no interest in making a new Black Moth record. I was done at Cobra Juicy, and that was 2012. And whatever was going on in my head kind of forced me to make Panic Blooms. And I knew it was a direct result of the way I was feeling. And it, I don't know, I guess it made me look at everything differently. And this is all kind of new, like realizing that all along it's just been me. Like, that's all kind of new, but yeah.
What were the feelings that you were having that led directly to that music?
I mean, it's nothing different from what most people deal with, you know? I was beating myself up pretty hard. And because of it, I wasn't sleeping, and it's kind of making me like deteriorate. You know, the less you sleep, the worse off you are. And I just got into this really weird, just kind of never ending, like fog. You could feel it. And it took me a little while to get out of it. I won't get into like why, I mean, but yeah, I think like having your brain kind of change like that a little bit, because it does. I think it does change your brain a little bit. Changes perspective sometimes.
Did something precipitate that happening?
It wasn't even like an event. And I guess I wasn't keeping myself busy during that time. Sometimes you need a purpose, I think. And there have been times where I haven't always had a purpose, and that was one of them. And it wasn't any like specific thing. It was just probably the way I always am, but letting it take over. Giving it that kind of power to take over, because I didn't have anything else to distract it with.
Oh,
So a lot of times depression can take away one's will to get out and make stuff happen in the world. You know, it's a very broad category, but like I'm basically talking about leaving the house, you know? And that is also kind of a condition of being a musician who works alone and loves to tinker with sounds. Like that also isn't a lifestyle that requires a lot of leaving the house. You know what I mean?
Right.
So do you find it hard when your get up and go is at low ebb? Do you find it hard that your lifestyle doesn't require you to go to the office every day or whatever it is that might break things up a little?
I've been there. Not anymore. Through all that, I kind of learned how to take care of myself, so that doesn't happen anymore. I definitely had a few periods where I'll just like not, I can't even, I have no interest in turning the equipment on, trying to write something. But I don't know, I keep myself busy. I don't really like, I don't go to shows or anything, but like, I don't know, we do enough stuff.
What kind of stuff do you like to do? I like to go to the thrift store.
I've always been like really big on fitness ever since I was in high school. So that's like, man, that's like 20 years now of this stuff. So I spent a lot of my time like studying that stuff and doing that stuff. I don't know, I think it'd be cool. Like right now I'm like working on trying to get a certification, like ACE certified to become a personal trainer. Not that I would ever use it because I can't imagine like actually training someone. It would just be fun to have that, be able to flash that, you know? I don't know if you get a card, but I would love to be able to flash that card.
What are the things that you like to do at the gym or health-wise?
Everything. It's like I think that world is kind of like, there are always new movements being invented, even though you think like the body can only move so many ways. Like someone's always coming up with some new thing or new way of doing things. And that stuff has always been interesting to me.
So I think if I went into a record store and I was looking for your record, they would probably be in a section labeled psychedelic rock or something like that. What is your relationship and your music's relationship to psychedelia as a phenomenon? Like how much is that of interest to you?
Oh man, it's like you knew to ask me that. I don't like that stuff. It's not like, did you know to ask me that?
Well, I'm professional. I'm doing my best.
I do not associate like Black Moth. That's where that people like to categorize that. It's not the kind of music I listen to. It's like I said, I was always like an Aphex, Otaker, Boards of Canada guy, and I always saw what I was doing as like my spin in that world. It didn't really work out that way because I don't think I'm really in that conversation. But yeah, I don't. The psych stuff is not really for me. Like with a lot of psych music, like the melodies and the songwriting was always like so just trying to like recapture the way people did things in the 60s and not really ever like expanding on it. I don't know. It's just so much of that stuff is so boring.
Did you always have the instinct when you make something pretty to make it, change it so it's more ugly?
No, that comes with, that came with age and starting to get bored by the simplicity of certain sounds and melodies. And I think when you're up front, it can be so boring. I don't know. I've tried to get better and better at not hiding it, but finding all the nooks and crannies that are in there.
Yeah, I read something where you were talking about wanting to make music that the person listening to it has the experience of still processing and working on it in their heads after the song has ended or the record has ended. And that made sense to me. I was like, I kind of understood that idea that you want to give people something that grows inside them afterwards rather than disappearing.
Yeah. I mean, like, when you put it all out there, even like lyrically, like if you just put it all out there and everything is straightforward and everything makes sense and everything's finished and everything's done, that's all there is to it. And for some people, that's fine. That'll stick. That'll resonate. When I was a kid, I liked not knowing what people were saying because your mind fills in the blanks. And it's kind of how I write my lyrics, is like, it's almost like stream of consciousness where you like, you might not be saying anything, but it means so much and you don't know why. But I think that all kind of ties into the not being finished, you know?
Are you interested in your music having a scary or discomforting quality? Like, I think of all the music that I've listened to regularly in my life, yours is probably the prettiest that I also find a little disconcerting.
I don't want to be scary because I think people who try to be scary are usually pretty corny. I mean, I don't want you to be comfortable all the time because that's so boring. I don't know, it has to shake you up somehow. Not all the time. I'm not trying to be like shocking or anything, but I don't know. I mean, that's life too, right? It's like equal and opposite.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm so happy to do it. We've like made an occasional request to have you on the show since I was making it by myself in my apartment probably 11 years ago or something. So I'm really nice. Grateful we could finally make it happen. I really love your music.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I was kind of surprised when I saw the list of people you guys interview. I was like, why would they ever talk to me?
I mean, the answer is because you've been on the list for 10 years. Thank you very much for doing it. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you.
Tobacco. The Black Moth Super Rainbow records are wonderful. Tobacco's solo records are also really good. We didn't get to talk about this during the interview, but he's got a new record with the rapper Aesop Rock. It's called Malibu Ken. Here's a track off of it. This is Corn Maze.
I'm the World Weekly News Bat Child. Beelining ash powder, ash pile. For every ghost climbing out the flat file. Every gaff, every lone spaz in a snack aisle. Cracked out, don't touch that dial ever. These trapdoors forecast quagmire weather, but it's worth it. From cobras out to kiss them on the cheek to snatching victory from out the jaws of imminent defeat.
That's it. The end of another episode of Bullseye. Bullseye produced at MaximumFun.org World Headquarters, overlooking MacArthur Park in beautiful Westlake, Los Angeles, California. In the park this week, a trio of dancers shot a video next to the lake. I'm told it was an impressive display of athleticism, that one of them had yellow sneakers, and that the wildlife and other park visitors regarded the scene indifferently. The show is produced by Speaking Into Microphones. Our producer is Kevin Ferguson. Jesus Ambrosio is our associate producer. We got help from Casey O'Brien. Our production fellow at Maximum Fun is Jordan Cowling. Our interstitial music is by DJW, also known as Dan Wally. Thanks to Dan for sharing it with us. Our theme song is Huddle Formation by the Go Team. Great band. Thanks to them for letting us use it. Thanks to their label, Memphis Industries. Our thanks to Helen at WESA in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, for helping with that interview with Tobacco. And before you go, did you know that Bullseye has 20 years of archives? Okay, it's like 18 years of archives, but still, a lot of archives. You can find them all on our website, MaximumFun.org. You can also find many of them on our YouTube channel, which you can find by searching for Bullseye with Jesse Thorn. Easy to listen to, easy to share there if you're one of those people who listens to stuff on YouTube. I know there's a lot of people who do that. You can also like us on Facebook. We share our interviews there. You can listen to them right there on Facebook if you want to. That's facebook.com/bullseyewithjessethorn. You into interviews with musicians? We did two. How about checking out our interview with Nile Rodgers from Chic? Whether or not you're into Chic, you will love it. Nile Rodgers is like the most amazing guy ever. The guy is a joy, a delight, that guy is. They're all on our website, MaximumFun.org, or in your favorite podcast app. You can find them. I think that's about it. Just remember, all great radio hosts have a signature sign-off.
Bullseye with Jesse Thorn is a production of MaximumFun.org and is distributed by NPR.